Okay, so we said that we'll be discussing about contradirectional coupling today, and so it's visible, right? Can you confirm?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So contradirectional coupling. So you remember that the contradirectional coupling means something we discussed, that coupling between forward propagating wave and backward propagating wave, and that is possible with a periodic grating structure if it is integrated or it is fabricated along with the waveguide. We can assume a single mode waveguide structure, typical 3D view. If I just sketch, you know that this suppose certain axis, and then the bottom layer may be oxide, box layer, and then you have a re-waveguide cross-sectional structure. You can say that this is your Y and this is your X, or XY, whatever you can consider, and this is your Z direction you can consider. This is your core. Basically you have N1, maybe N2, this can be N3 refractive index. So this is your waveguide cross section. Okay, so this is typically, this we are considering Z axis, so XYZ. Probably we can write this one maybe X, and this can be considered Y. Okay, so now this waveguide, if you just think about that, okay, periodically if you can reduce the height, you can reduce little bit of height periodically, then this height reduction should not be, if this is your H, capital H, and this height reduction you can think of something like this, very little, which can be delta H, can be much much less than capital H. That is one type of grating you can fabricate. And another type of grating you can think of, so this is your waveguide cross section. So what you would do, you can periodically, you can just reduce the width instead of height. You can just reduce periodically some width. So something you can just imagine that way it is done. So this structure, its width typically it is W. So in this case, you can think of W1 for example. In that case, this W minus W1 equal to delta W, that must be much much less than W. Okay, so small perturbation that can be width wise or that can be height wise. Okay, but this thing we can actually, for our understanding purpose, contradirectional coupling understanding purpose, when there is a grating, we'll just take a lateral section of the waveguide. So lateral section of the waveguide, you can just imagine that, okay, this is your core layer. This is your core layer. This is a Z axis, and this is X axis. We can consider this is your X axis. Okay, and this is your core. And here is your box, bottom box, and core silicon N1. This is N2, and top layer may be N3. I'm just considering lateral section. Z axis this one. Okay, and you can have this one is your so-called H, height we can consider. It can be width, it can be height. If it is width direction, I can also represent just top view. If it is height, we can just represent like that. And then if you can just do some kind of periodically height modulation, it can be a little bit raised height or it can be reduced height. So this type of modulation is there. So I can just simply, instead of this, I can just sketch like this. So I can just height modulation periodically. That can be duty cycle 50%. Sorry, 50%, okay. So like this, you can just consider. So this way, right? So in that case, we can think of that light wave is propagating. Let me just consider this H is removed here. Okay, just for, I'm cleaning this just for understanding purpose. Okay, so Z axis or whatever we can consider here. Yeah, fine. So, and also this one I remove. So you just imagine that this is the core of the waveguide I've just sketched here. And you have a periodic perturbation, something like that. And you can say that at say Z equal to zero, you have perturbation, your perturbation started, and it can continue say up to Z equal to say here, Z equal to L, this perturbation continued. And after that, again, it is a continuous waveguide, something like this. Okay, so then this Z equal to zero to Z equal to L, we can just consider that that is actually so-called grating structure. Say LGR or LG, something like that, we can just represent. This is the total length. In this case, we can consider simply L. Okay, sometimes it can be considered as a LGR, that does not matter. So we can just consider something like this. Now, we can assume that this waveguide is a single mode waveguide. So single mode waveguide, you can imagine two confined guided mode, but one should be in the forward propagating, another should be in the backward propagating, that's it. Single moded, and also we can assume that when it is single moded, it can be TE or TM, anyone, anything. It should not be, if it is in principle, literally, if TE fundamental mode and TM fundamental mode both are present, then normally we don't call that as a single mode, because single mode in TE polarization, you can imagine one mode, and for TM orientation also you can get another mode. So in principle, that is a multimode. So in this case, ideally we are considering that, okay, this waveguide is just a single mode, you can consider it like a either TE or TM, something like that. So in that case, so one mode can be propagating, I can imagine, propagating in the right hand side with a plus beta propagation constant, and another will be, you can imagine, minus beta. Okay, sorry. Okay, minus beta, this direction, plus beta or minus beta, you can consider. The mode solutions will be same. Mode distribution, field distribution will be same. Okay, but thing is that this is a waveguide, and you can have solutions for forward propagating wave and backward propagating wave. But as long as you are not exciting them, it's just passive, nothing is happening inside. So you can excite maybe forward direction, a wave you can excite in the forward direction. As long as no perturbation is there, that forward direction mode that will travel in the forward direction all the time. You cannot see any back reflection, right? Because it is a eigen mode and continuous waveguide, it should go. But once you have this type of perturbation, you have some kind of orthogonality, breaking the orthogonality condition, so that is disturbed, and because of that disturbance, there is a high chance that light can be coupled from forward propagating wave to some another confined mode which is traveling in the backward direction. And if it is traveling in the backward direction, can we control that, okay, it is reflecting back, but is it possible that only a certain band of wavelength will be reflecting, others will be propagating? Then it is a good device. It is a good filter device. So that is the ultimate idea, to have a periodic structure so that a particular any perturbation that will actually give you certain kind of back reflection, right? But anything back reflection, that is a loss. Normally, typically some back reflection you don't want. Perturbation, you should avoid it. But if you just create certain kind of periodic perturbation and you design the period according to your need, then it is possible that a certain band of wavelength that will be reflected to the backward direction and coupled to the backward mode. So in that case, backward direction mode will be excited automatically due to the perturbation. Even though you are launching in the forward direction, you will see that backward direction modes are getting excited. Okay, now just I can refresh a bit here. Suppose you have a again, this is your continuous thing and this is your continuous waveguide section, and say this is your, so this is your z equal to 0, and then you have all the modulation is there, some periodic modulation is there up to z equal to l. I'm just reproducing here, and I said that suppose you have a mode propagating in this direction. Okay, you have launched with A1. Normally, you know, certain mode we defined earlier, that any mode, a single mode, I don't need to write aim or something like that. Something we can say that E, X, Y, Z, if that is a mode, electric field associated with a mode. So I can just, instead of that, I can write T. So you can have EXY, okay, EXY, and then e to the power j omega t minus beta z. And this is, if this is a profile, you can have, let me just clean this one bit. You can write something EXYZ t. So this will be this one. Yeah. So EUXY is the period, sorry, profile. And if you can consider, if it is normalized and normalization constant, you can consider something like that A. And if there is a perturbation, we can consider that this amplitude, the normalization constant, can be considered as a Z dependent, some kind of variation can happen. So this is the waveguide's mode. You can have a guided mode with this type of solution. So Z can be as a function of Z, this amplitude can be modulated, it can be reduced, it can be increased, or whatever. It's possible, right? So I can consider that if you are launching in the forward direction, say E1 mode, considering forward direction, it will be something this type of mode is there. And backward direction, if it is there, what would be the solution? Suppose this is E2, X, Y, Z, it's a vector, and I can write A2Z, and profile will be same, similar almost, we can consider E to the power J, omega T, and this one will be what I should write, plus beta z. So this is actually forward propagating wave. And this will be backward. So this is the existing solution as I mentioned before. And you are launching here, just giving some value to A1, so that this is actually energized, this gets some life in the forward direction. So you have, I'm just only, because all other things are similar, so I only consider A1 0, you have launched here. That is the total amplitude. It can be volt per meter, whatever things, electric field. Associated magnetic field I'm not considering, only electric field I'm considering for the guided mode, A1 0. Then what happens, because of the perturbation, you have this periodic perturbation is there, right? So on, periodic perturbation is there up to here. So I see that this A10 will not remain constant. That is going to change. So let me try. Okay, it will be say A1L. Forward direction, whatever it is coming, it will be A1L. Then after reaching L, since again it is no perturbation, so this amplitude will be similarly like this, just a1, simple a1 e to the e xy, whatever value comes, a1 l will remain there, xy and e to the power j omega t minus beta z, it will propagate like that. So if I know what is the value of a1 l here, then I will be able to know what is transmitting there with amplitude. And next thing is that, as usual, like waveguide mode, I can treat them. Okay, and in this case you will not have any backward propagating wave. That direction you are not launching anything, you have excited only in this direction, right? So backward direction nothing is there. So that means if I consider a to l, that must be equal to zero here. We can consider some situation you will find in an integrated circuit that this a to l may not be zero, something coming from other device. If it is cascaded to other device, this may not be equal to zero. But if you are just discussing stand alone rating structure, then you can consider that backward direction nothing is coming out, coming inside, only you are launching from this side, and then perturbation comes, after perturbation it is going here. But as you know, that as it goes, there is a chance that because of the perturbation, some energy may be, it's a disturbed, and then energy can be coupled back to the backward direction, and it can feed to this mode, so that can get some life because of the perturbation. So in between I can have certain value a to z, which is backward direction it is propagating, and I have I should have in mind that a to l, originally exactly at a to l it was zero, backward propagating mode was not there, it will originate from here only and then it will come here. And whatever things, because it is backward direction, I can say that whatever coming out here a to as a to zero, that amplitude, that will again continue here in the backward direction with this formula, a to zero xy e to the power j omega t beta z. Okay, so now I would like to know, is this situation can be wavelength dependent? Because only if I suppose you have a laser source you are launching for all wavelength, if this is happening to all wavelength, then I think it is something simply it is a reflector, it's like a normal mirror type reflector, all wavelength will be reflecting. That is not so very important, very useful. You can just, if you want everything back, I think it's not a device at all for integrated optics. Okay, so you get this thing. So now if you would like to know that, okay, how much it is reflecting and how much it is transmitting, even though it is a wavelength dependent or not, that is also one thing, particular wavelength if it is reflecting, for example some band. So in that case I would like to know, because of the presence of this structure, periodic perturbation structure, what is the transmission and what is the reflection. I can define reflection coefficient as a to zero, whatever the value it is coming and whatever I have launched here. So that is your reflection coefficient. You take the amplitude ratio, whatever you have launched and whatever coming out of, you can consider like a black box now. Okay, you only know that you can measure what is coming out, a to zero. So you take a ratio, and since it is amplitude, and just a square and take ratio, that then you will be getting reflectivity. That is actually reflectivity. If you are not taking a square, that is a reflection coefficient, amplitude ratio. Okay, similarly if I try to write t equal to what is the transmission, transmission means I have launched a10 and output side you have only forward propagating wave, no backward propagating wave will be there at z greater than l. So this is l. Okay, so t will be equal to, I can write a1l divided by a10. So this is your basically you can say that this is a transfer matrix, transfer function of a grating structure. Okay, now next thing is that whether this is a this R can be a frequency dependent or T can be a frequency dependent or not. If you just consider that other than light scattered only into backward direction and it is not coupling to the any other direction, any other mode, then obviously you can say that this R plus T must be equal to 1. Reflection coefficient plus reflectivity plus transmittivity, that should be equal to 1. Energy should be conserved because no energy is not scattered into any other modes. Any other modes means what type of modes? You can think of that, okay, there are leaky modes always there. There are leaky, it is not coupling to the other leaky modes. So to have the coupling between restricted between this forward propagating wave and backward propagating wave, you need to have certain kind of phase matching condition I discussed before. Okay, so our intention is that to find out the expression for this one. If you are not taking a square, then you have to have only R omega, just reflection coefficient as a frequency dependent, T as a frequency dependent. So in that case, I can say that R omega, it can be complex star plus T omega and T omega star, that is actually giving you R, and that is actually giving you R square plus T square, that should be equal to 1. So whenever you want to consider that, okay, this device cascaded to another device, that time this reflectivity alone will not be a good thing to be solved for analysis. Because whenever you are taking reflectivity, you are losing the phase information. Intensity you are getting. What is the amplitude phase you are losing? But in integrated optics, this phase information is very, very important because you need to see what, if you are trying to see mixing of two different waves, coupling between two other waves coming from other source, then you need to see what is their associated phase. Okay, so that information is needed. So first of all, I need to find out what is the A20 by A10, then I will be getting R omega or then T omega. And then if I want to know as a standalone device, like a grating structure, then I just take the intensity alone, that's fine. And for complicated additional advanced structure circuits, so you need to go for phase. Okay, so first of all, if you want this structure, this grating structure, this should be phase matched so that coupling can happen between these two modes only, then no losses are there. So that type of device, if you can design, that is a good for a certain application, right? So first of all, I will try to discuss a little bit qualitatively what happens in a period, what can happen in a periodic structure. Okay, qualitatively, if I just try to, yes, if you see, if you just take only one particular period, so you have something like this. So you just continue maybe another one. Okay, just remove this one. Okay, so I have this one. If I start from here, okay, or maybe I can start from here. Let us consider this one. Okay, I just consider this is your waveguide structure and this is your just perturbation, height perturbation or width perturbation, whatever way you can imagine, you can think that way. Okay, and then I know that suppose from here it is continuous. Okay. Now let us see what happens for a particular period. So you start from here, then another period starts up to here, one period, right? This is actually one period. Okay. And how much fraction its width or height is higher, that is actually duty cycle. That's normal duty cycle you can consider, right? You just imagine like that. So what happens to one period? That will be actually giving you a good idea what can happen to the next period also, because it is a periodic structure. So here, what is happening, for example, any wave is coming here. You can imagine that up to here, it is one waveguide dimension was there, and then suddenly your waveguide dimension is changed. For if it is just 50% duty cycle, you can consider lambda by 2 part, this is lambda by 2 part. You have a different waveguide width or height. And then again coming back to same height. So what can happen for an incoming wave? A guided mode coming here, some guided mode coming here. So what can happen because of the sudden change in the width or height? What do you expect? Anyone can tell me? Just let us not consider coupled mode theory for the moment. You just imagine that wave is coming, a certain waveguide, some waveguide is there, certain width is there, and suddenly you have changed. Height is changed, little bit, even if it is a little bit. And abrupt.
It try to excite higher order modes. Like
it is a single mode also. You are right, that is a multi-mode interferometer. Normally, you can have, if it is a higher order modes are there, different modes are there, then it will see what is the overlap. And if you are exciting higher order modes or not, you can see from the overlap integral. That's true. But you can consider that is also multimode. So you are launching here, and then suddenly abrupt waveguide width, even though it is a small, you see some change there. What thing you can expect?
Like some reflection.
Some reflection, because it is actually, you know, in this region, you have a wave effective index must be one, an effective one we can define, and here an effective two. Which one will be higher?
Two.
An effective two will be higher. Because the dimension is bigger, normally we have seen your simulations, etc. If you have done so, you would be knowing that width is varying, increasing means your effective index, even though fundamental mode effective index will be increasing. So that will be there. So in that case, this mode, if you are launching, what do you expect? That a fraction will be reflected at this particular point. And that reflection you can actually estimate if you know an effective one and an effective two. What is the fraction it will be reflected?
That is ineffective 2 minus ineffective 1.
According to the Fresnel's law.
Yeah.
Fresnel's equation. So you can write ineffective 2 minus ineffective 1. It is a normal incidence you can consider, right? Ineffective 2 plus ineffective 1. That is gamma, right? That gamma t, you remember that when we discussed about total internal reflection angle dependencies, etc. there. So in this case, we don't consider angle. We can consider just guided mode and normal incidence. We can just roughly, you can estimate how much will be reflected back. That is the reflex amplitude reflection coefficient. Is that correct? Okay. So this will be, that means if something coming here, I see that something will be reflected in the first abrupt change here. Something will be reflected here. And majority will be traveling back, traveling inside. Then you will see another abrupt change. There you are again modifying from ineffective 2 to ineffective 1. So there also you will see some kind of reflection, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
So,
yes, sir.
So that means it goes there and then you can see something reflected here. So I see going here, I just showing here something it will be reflected and then some part will come back this direction and it will, and some again it will go that direction also. And here also whatever reflection will be there, I'm not considering whatever going that again it will be reflecting, but I want to see what is coming in the backward direction. So if this is E1 and this would be E2, right? You understand, this is your, I'm just extending this one. So in the first interface, some reflection, and then second interface, some reflection, and that will pass through the another interface and can come, whatever fraction comes, I'm just considering as a E2. This is E1 and this is E2. Now, this is the half period. I just travel up to half period and something goes and then reach to the another similar situation, whatever happened here, same type of position, coordinate, if you are reaching there. There also again you will see, whatever it will go there, fraction it will be reflected back and it will come back, travel all the way, whatever survive, I just consider that is actually E3, right? So in principle, what I see that I have E1 within a period. When it is starting, you have E1, and then I have E2, and then I have E3, right? Now, if you something to build in the backward direction, they should not be destructively interfering. Is that correct? This E1, E2, E3, they should build. They should not canceling each other. Right? Now you just imagine that. What will happen? What would be the phase of between E1 and E2? Just phase, fraction, you will be calculating like that, right? I'm right. Just asking you, what would be the phase between E1 and E2?
It depends on the difference and the distance travel.
Exactly.
E power j beta lambda by 2, not
suppose lambda by 2.
And beta so, is 2 pi by lambda into n effective.
Let us consider beta is approximately same.
Yeah.
So beta lambda by 2, right, times 2, right? Beta lambda by 2 times 2. And then this is a phase. Anything else? Additional phase will be there? Any other thing? So forward direction, it will be having this one, beta times L. And backward direction, it will be this one. Only this much phase or any other phase change?
Plus pi.
Huh?
Pi.
Plus pi. Because you know, first here, you are just having a reflection, n effective 2 minus n effective 1. So there, you don't have any plus, a minus sign, only plus. N effective is higher than the, n effective 2 is higher than the n effective 1. But whenever something happening in the next layer, that is again an effective 1, right? So in that case, additional pi phase, negative sign will be there. When it is E2 is coming, there will be a negative sign. So pi will be there, right? Is that clear? Okay. Now, 2 cancel. So that means this beta lambda plus pi. So you have beta lambda plus pi phase shift between phase difference between E1 and E2. Now let us see what is the phase difference between E1 and E3. What would be the phase difference? U1 and E3. So similarly, we can calculate beta lambda times 2 plus any other phase. This is E1 and E2. And this is E1 and E3. Tell me.
Plus pi.
Plus pi will be there?
Yes. No, sir. Lower to higher. So not it's not be there.
Because I am just E1 and I'm considering E3. E3 is coming just reflection from here only.
Yes, sir.
So it is traveling and coming back to this one. So it is an identical situation. So E1 and E3, you will not see any additional pi phase difference. Right? So in that case, what will happen? This is zero. So E1 and E3, between E1 and E3, you have just exactly 2 beta lambda difference. Okay, if you just match this lambda such that, this capital lambda, if you match such that, it is exactly 2 pi. This is identical. Suppose it is 2 pi. So what will happen? 2 pi. A 2 beta by lambda, I can calculate, right? So I just simply calculate here. Your 2 into 2 pi by lambda, n effective, that is beta, right? Into lambda equal to 2 times pi. Suppose they are in phase, exactly 2 pi, right? E1 and E3 exactly in phase. One round trip, it is 2 pi. Just assume, then what happens?
Sir, this n effective is n effective 1.
Average n effective I'm putting in this case. Okay, when I'm just clubbing with beta, I'm just considering average, just for simplicity. Actually, you are right. That would be the case. We can calculate like that. We'll come to that point later. Just for qualitative understanding, I'm just discussing here. Okay, so suppose a round trip, little bit perturbation is there, and effective is not changing much, assumed. So 2 pi cancel. Right? So this lambda should be equal to what? Lambda should be equal to capital lambda equal to lambda by 2 n effective. If you have period of this kind, then this particular lambda, you can see constructive interference between E1 and E3. What happens to E2? E1 and E2 then? If 2 beta lambda is 2 pi, beta lambda, it is also pi, it is also pi, it is also 2 pi. So that means all E1, E2, E3, they are in phase. So that means every reflection, every point it is reflected, they are reaching here in with same phase. That means that particular lambda, it will build in the backward direction. So if you can design your periodic perturbation with a period capital, just if you approximately, you just write approximately because you are complaining that why you are writing ineffective. Lambda times 2 n effective. If you are just putting like that, n effective is the average effective index. Then this particular lambda electromagnetic wave, that will couple to the backward mode, backward propagating mode. So a particular wavelength, which is actually exactly matching to this one, this situation, then it is called, this type of device can be useful for a reflection, wavelength specific, wavelength dependent reflection, or a particular wavelength will be reflected in the backward direction. So this is in principle, qualitatively we understand that if you have a periodic structure, something like this, you can use this appropriately for certain device application. Clear? So now let us come back to our original coupled mode equation. If you have forgotten, I'm just writing down, you try to remember. Remember that the A1 Z forward propagating wave, how it evolves, it will be minus J kappa A2Z e to the power J delta beta Z, and then dA2Z by dZ equal to plus J kappa star A1Z e to the power minus J delta beta Z. You remember that if it is co-directional coupling, both will be same sign. If it is contra-directional coupling, we have derived that this should be an opposite sign, beta 1 multiplied by beta 2, that should be plus or minus, depending on that, we decide this sign. This is for contra-directional coupling case. This is the two coupled mode equation. Is that clear? What is delta beta? You remember that? You assume that periodic perturbation, it is actually, it can be decomposed into Fourier components, right? So in that case, beta delta beta will be beta 1, typically beta 1 minus beta 2 minus Fourier order m by 2 pi lambda. You remember that? I hope all of you remembering this, right?
Yes, sir.
When we discussed coupled mode theory. But here, beta 1 equal to minus beta 2 equal to beta. We are considering coupling between forward propagating mode to backward propagating mode. And they are single mode. That is a single mode waveguide. So I'm just considering beta 1 equal to minus beta 2. Sine I'm considering, it should be beta equal to say omega by c. N effective is the effective index of the average effective index of the waveguide. Or we can write 2 pi by lambda N effective. Okay, so in that case, delta beta we can write equal to 2 times beta minus M 2 pi by lambda. And you know the maximum coupling can take place when delta beta equal to? Come on.
Zero.
That is phase matching condition. So when delta beta equal to zero, then you just do this one bit. 2 times 2 pi by lambda N effective equal to M 2 pi by lambda. Right? 2 pi cancel. And then you see, if I try to calculate lambda, then you are getting M times lambda, that means operating wavelength lambda by 2 N effective. If M equal to 1, for M equal to 1, that a first order Fourier harmonics, if you are just considering, then you have lambda equal to lambda by 2 N effective. Exactly what I have discussed in the here. So here we discussed this one. Period, if it is lambda by 2 N effective, then you can see that something building in the backward direction. And here we have also shown that coupled mode theory also, we know that delta beta is the phase matching condition if it is a periodic structure. After considering all the Fourier harmonics, and we just consider if the phase matching happening because of the M equal to 1, first order Fourier harmonics actually contributing to the phase matching condition. If M equal to 2, it may not match for certain wavelength, this particular wavelength. Okay, so then coupling will be possible. But I would like to know, it is actually phase matching for a certain lambda. We call this lambda is a Bragg wavelength, lambda B. But I know that even if it is delta beta not equal to zero, slightly close to zero, that means you can get some another wavelength also. That also can contribute to the backward coupling. That means as a device, is it operate exactly at phase matching wavelength or slightly deviation also that can also contribute some kind of reflection, some kind of contribution. So to understand that, we'll be just considering. Yeah. To understand that.
Sir, can you just repeat this part that when you discuss delta beta equal to zero and for first order Fourier harmonics, we get exactly same condition. After that, what you told, my connection is lost basically.
So this is actually, you understand that M equal to one. I know that if it is a rectangular periodic perturbation, so periodic perturbation, you can just, spatial perturbation, you can just decompose into Fourier harmonics, right? You remember that we have discussed that?
Yes, sir.
So that Fourier harmonics, and if different type of Fourier harmonics, if it is there, so we can consider mth Fourier harmonics, the delta beta can be calculated like this. That is also, you know, right? Now if you are choosing your operating wavelength lambda such that m equal to 1, you are getting phase matching condition. So if your lambda operating wavelength is fixed, right? And you want m equal to 1 to be phase matched, then you calculate your required period should be lambda by 2n effective. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Right? So if I put m equal to 2, but my lambda is fixed, then if m equal to, instead of 1, lambda is fixed, if I put m equal to 2, that will not be delta beta equal to 0, right? So I'm saying that a particular Fourier harmonics will help me phase matching condition for a certain wavelength. If you change the Fourier harmonics, m equal to 1 to m equal to 2, then that will phase match to some other wavelength. I am interested in my integrated optics to operate at a particular wavelength. So I can consider, okay, certain period I can consider, and that period will contribute so many Fourier harmonics, but all the Fourier harmonics will be hopeless, useless. In my case, only m equal to 1, that is matters, because I am operating in a certain wavelength range. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
So all what I'm saying that we have all the mathematical tools available to us, but we have to design our device according to our requirement. Okay. So now my point is that, all right, I have phase matched condition. I know that I ensure that the power will be coupled to the backward direction. Now, how much power will be coupled to the backward direction? What are the parameters? Depends on how many periods you are using. What is the length of your periodic perturbation, a grating structure? And also this kappa. This is the coupling. You see, if you just simply check, this is the coupling strength. How much it is contributing, how much fraction of A2 contributing to the differential change in the A1. So kappa. Kappa calculation also, kappa expression, you know, we have discussed earlier. Right? So now my target is that to use this equation to find out either R omega, T omega, or R lambda, T lambda, or R omega, T omega for a given length of the grating and for a given single mode waveguide and for a given perturbation, meaning given kappa. So I mean to say LG known to you, kappa known to you, assumed that can be calculated from your solver. You can calculate mode solver and then overlap integral you can calculate omega by 4 and so on, so on. We have discussed earlier, right? So that numerically you can calculate kappa and then you know the similar type of periodic structure if you fabricate for a length of L, then I would like to know what is the value, how much reflection can be achieved. The question is, can we keep on increasing the length so that reflectivity can be completely, can be one? Entirely it will be reflected. It will be reflected for a certain wavelength. Or what would be the nature? We need to know that. For that purpose, what we'll do? We'll just consider this equation. This two equation, and we consider delta beta, some value can be close to zero, can be away from zero. This is a general coupled mode theory. Using that thing, I will try to solve. If I solve this, I think then I will be knowing how to design a particular DBS structure, whether particular lambda will be reflected or not, and how much band will be reflected, what is the length required, and whether it can be useful for certain applications or not. All those type of things we'll be knowing. So let us try to see. So just considering this is just equation 1 and equation 2. How to solve that? You know, we have already solved similar equation, but with the same sign. Here only opposite sign, right? How we have done? We have tried to eliminate. They are coupled equation. We can eliminate A2 from equation 1. You just make a derivative of first equation, then wherever dA2 by dZ is there, that place you are just put down your A1 value, then you can get. The same way you have done for co-directional coupling, you can try that, but your equation will be slightly different. I'm just writing that one. So I will have, by eliminating A2Z from equation 1, using equation 2, of course, you can get dA1Z dZ minus J delta beta dA1 dZ kappa square A1Z. This is equal to 0. I think this is minus also. You can check. This will be minus or not. Check. Can you confirm me? Simply, you just take a derivative and you put down. It will be minus sign. I think in case of co-directional coupling, that will be plus minus. Only one plus minus will be different. Okay. Now from here, you can solve, basically. You can find out. This is a second order differential equation. You can assume something e to the power mz and then standard way, second order. Because delta beta, you assume that is known. Delta beta known. Delta beta assumed. Assume. Delta beta known, kappa square known. These are second order differential equations. But only thing is that you have some complex imaginary parties there. You have to handle that. So the solutions, standard way, if you just put, normally complex solutions you can consider also for a differential equation. So A1Z, I'm just writing the solution, final solution, how it will be looking like. Delta beta by 2Z. And some constant I put here, cosine SZ plus C2 sine SZ. Right? I think that's it. And A2Z, once I get A1, using this A1, I can find from the equation 2 what is the value of A2Z. That will be J by kappa e to the power minus j delta. You can check this one, this solution's coming correctly or not. So we can put j c1 is a constant. We have to find that one by using the boundary condition. Sz plus J C2 delta beta by 2 minus C1 S sine SZ. Okay. So C1 and C2 are constant. Because differential equation, whenever you are solving, you always face with some constants, and those constants you can solve by using the help of boundary condition. What are the boundary condition in this case? A1 0 can be A1 0 is a known. How much amplitude is there? Known. That can be 1 watt, corresponding to 1 watt, right? So that is known to you. What about A2L? A2L value? That would be 0. So these two things known. Using this two known value, I can find out two equations, na? C1 and C2, two unknowns. We can find C1 and C2 and replace that here. Okay? So using this boundary values, find out C1 and C2 and try to find A1Z and A2Z under this boundary condition, whatever the value. So once you know that one, then you can easily find out what is the reflectivity, what is the transmittivity, and what is the different dependencies on delta beta also. Okay, we'll discuss that in the next class, this thing. If you have any questions till now. Okay, then I stop.
Sir, I have some not related to the course, but I have some, I mean, I want to talk something to you.